Healthcare reform is one of two major challenges facing President Obama over the next 48 hours. The other is climate change, of course. David Axelrod is the president's senior advisor. I spoke with him late this afternoon from the White House briefing room. David Axelrod, welcome. Is healthcare reform now in serious jeopardy in the Senate?
No, I think we are where we were, Jim. We've got strong support in the Senate for health insurance reform. We've got a minority of senators who want to keep that from coming up for a vote on the Senate floor. And we're working to put together the 60 votes that we need to bring it to the floor, and I'm confident that we're going to get them.
Senator Ben Nelson, as you know, said today that he has renewed reservations about what's in that bill because of the abortion issue. He's one of the 60 you're counting on. What do you think of that?
Well, look, there are many issues that have been raised by him and others. We're going to work our way through those issues. Again, I'm confident that we're going to get this done and in a way that will hold a coalition together.
What do you make of this rising opposition among liberal Democrats, particularly led by former Democratic Chairman Howard Dean?
Well, look, I think that a lot of people have a great deal of passion about this issue. I have a great deal of passion about it myself. I have someone in my family with a chronic illness, and I've had many of the horrific experiences with insurance that other Americans have had, and I feel strongly about this, and so does the president. So, you know, people are impassioned, and there are some disagreements about aspects of this plan, but there is absolutely no doubt that the reforms that we're working on will be infinitely better than the situation that we face today. People will be able to get insurance that they can afford, even if they don't get it through work. Small businesses will get tax credits, and they'll be able to provide health care to people. There'll be protections for people who have pre-existing conditions. You won't be able to get thrown off your insurance just because you become seriously ill. There'll be caps on out-of-pocket expenses, so you won't go bankrupt if you get seriously ill. These are reforms that are long overdue, and we're so close to getting it done. I agree with President Clinton, who said today that it would be a tremendous blunder to miss this opportunity, and it probably won't come around again.
What do you make, then, of the public opinion polls, at least, showing a diminishment and a growing drop in support for health care reform? If all these things you say are true, what is the public not understanding?
Well, that's an interesting question, Jim, because what you find is that if you ask people how you feel about the bill that's going through Congress, you get a negative reaction. If you tell them what's in the bill, then you get a healthy majority for the bill. And I think, you know, the legislative process isn't always an attractive thing, and it tends to focus on areas of contention. The things that I've mentioned, I think, are broadly supported by the American people. They want it. They know we need it. And when they hear that that's in the bill, they support the bill. I have no doubt that once this bill is passed and implemented, the American people will appreciate it, and it's going to improve the lives of people across this country who are struggling in this health care system today.
You're not concerned about, or Andrew Kohut, for instance, a distinguished pollster, says his reading of the polls is that the real drop in support is among liberal Democrats, the people you would expect to be supporting the most health care reform.
Well, look, there's been some contention over some issues. The president was supported the idea of a public option within the health insurance exchange and felt that would be a good idea. That did not prevail. We weren't able to cobble together the support we needed for that. But that was just a piece of a large package of reforms. And when you measure what we've lost against what we would gain, there's absolutely no doubt that people that this is a very progressive piece of legislation that would make this country fairer, that would help people in their relationships with their insurance companies, give them some leverage, put the consumer in charge, and would help bend the curve on costs, on premiums for people, on the cost for government, absolutely essential. All of these things will be achieved if we get this done, and I think the American people will appreciate it once we get it done.
You're obviously monitoring all of this. Is the idea of having all this done in the Senate by Christmas, which is just a week away, Is that no longer on the table?
No, we're working hard to try and get that done. The other side is working hard to stop that by putting up procedural barriers. Understand that there's a majority in the Senate that is ready to pass this bill. There's a minority that wants to thwart the opportunity for the bill to come up for a vote. I think whether you're for or against this bill, after all these months of debate, thorough, thoughtful debate, it's time to allow a vote to come to the floor. And that's really what the argument is right now. It's not even about the bill itself. It's about whether we're going to have a vote on the bill.
If there's no vote by Christmas, is this a serious setback for the legislation generally?
Let me say this. I spoke with the president this afternoon. We expect that we'll have a vote before the holiday, but there is no length to which of time. There's no statute that's going to run in terms of getting this done for the American people. We are going to get this done for the American people, because it is the best chance we've had. Seven presidents have tried to reform this health insurance system. Seven presidents have failed. We've been struggling with it for 100 years. We are closer now. We are right on the doorstep of getting it done. We are going to get it done.
The president's going to be at Copenhagen in the morning at the climate conference. What has he come to say and do?
Well, our hope is we are very committed to investments in clean energy. Obviously, climate change is a real and perilous challenge, not just for the U.S., but the world. We want to address that, but we are also committed to creating a clean energy industry in this country that will create jobs, will create energy, more energy independence. So we're pursuing that role, but we want the world to join together. That's the most effective way to deal with climate change, and we're hoping to come out of Copenhagen with an agreement that is verifiable. In other words, an agreement on which we can all have assurance that countries are meeting the domestic goals that they set for themselves. And the president is going to talk to his fellow heads of state to see if we can achieve that.
What if you can't?
Well, look, we're going to pursue our goals regardless. We are committed to making that transition to a clean energy economy. And we will pursue in the future global agreements. But this is an opportunity and to try and get this done. And we're hopeful that other countries, including China, will be just as committed to getting it done.
Has the president had direct contact with the Chinese leadership going into Copenhagen about this?
Well, you know, Jim, he's talked about this with the Chinese leadership several times over the course of this year. Secretary Clinton is in Copenhagen now. She met with the Chinese premier today, and the president will be meeting with them tomorrow. And we hope that we can get. We made some progress in our previous talks. We have to get over the hump in terms of being able to demonstrate to the world that we're all meeting our obligations under whatever agreement we make. And that's been a bit of a hurdle, but we hope to deal with it.
If there is no agreement, is the summit a failure?
Well, I don't think so. I think that we've made progress there. It's not as it hasn't come as easily as anyone would like. These are difficult issues, but whatever happens there, there'll undoubtedly be more work to do. I think the fact that the world is really focused as intensely as it is on this issue, that there's a recognition that we have to act, and that the impact of not acting will be dramatic and devastating over a long period of time for the world, I think is a positive thing. But we want tangible, specific, domestic goals each country can agree to. They're not all going to be the same, because countries are different. Some are developed, some are not. But we all have to pitch in and meet our common obligations. And that's what the president is going to say, and that's what I hope we'll do.
Finally, Mr. Axelrod, does the president still maintain his support for Ben Bernanke to have a second term as chairman of the Federal Reserve?
Absolutely, Jim. When you consider where we were a year ago, and on the doorstep of financial collapse that could have ushered in a second Great Depression, and you consider the indefatigable efforts of Chairman Bernanke, he deserves a second term. That's why the president nominated him, and he continues to support him.
All right. David Axelrod, thank you very much.
Okay. Good to be with you.
Yep.